Right. Now this section will be a basic introduction about part called cosmology, and for the special degree students we will go into more details later, but this is like a basic introduction for the cosmology and the Big Bang theory. So I guess it will be important for you before we start to talk about these topics in detail. Right, so in the morning we actually discussed about the galaxies and their properties, and so if there are any general degree students, you may remember that we studied different types of galaxies and then classification of galaxies and about the galaxy groups and galaxy clusters in the morning. Now we are going to move into the next section, which is about the study of the origin and the nature of the universe itself. So what we will talk here is the nature of the universe and also the origin of the universe. And this is referred as cosmology. And we will be talking about a number of observations which will help us to learn about this part called cosmology. The one thing that we will be looking at is the motions of galaxies. Even though we talk about properties of galaxies, we did not discuss much about the motions of galaxies, which tells us about the dynamical state of the universe. And this will help to predict the fate of the universe, what will happen to the universe in the future. And second, we will also look at the large-scale distribution of galaxies, how the galaxies are distributed in the space. And this will help us to get an idea about the structure of the universe. And then if you go into the next step, which is about looking out to extremely large distances. So you can look back in time, which means you are looking at very large distances back, where you could see how the universe has evolved with time, right? So the idea is, when you have these large telescopes, you can go and look at more and more back into the time, which gives you an idea about how the universe has evolved at different times, right? So that we will be discussing about these things. Now the first thing is, or the first point is about the motions of galaxies in the universe. Now there was an astronomer called Vesto. He's an American astronomer. In 1912, he looked at some of the spectra of these nearby spiral galaxies. So there are a set of spiral galaxies which are very nearby, and then these galaxies actually back then it was known as spiral nebulas, because we did not realize that they were galaxies at that time. However, you probably have learned in the morning that how we discovered this Andromeda galaxy using Seppi variables, right? And similarly, this American astronomer was looking at spectra of these nearby spiral galaxies, and he noticed something very strange, that is, and these spectra were shifted in wavelength, right? So they are basically shifted. And this was attributed to relative motion between the spiral nebula and us, which resulted in the Doppler effect, right? Now, that makes sense, because if there is a motion of galaxies due to the gravity, what we would normally expect is, for example, if this is the Andromeda galaxy, we will expect that this particular galaxy will move towards us, right? Because of the gravity, everything normally gets attracted. So that is normal. But and this is also called as the Doppler effect, right? Relative motions of galaxies. But he was very surprised to see that nearly all of the galaxies that he observed moving away from us, right? And instead of having a blue shift, which means the increase of the the frequency and the decrease of the wavelength, he observed a redshifted spectra, right? Not blue shifted, right? Now, what that means is basically if something is redshifted, so that means the wavelength has increased. And what that means is this particular object is moving away from us, right? Now, at that time, this was a complete mystery, right? And you should be able to understand that it makes sense because due to the gravity, one would expect that the Andromeda galaxy may come towards us due to the attraction force, right? I mean, that makes sense. But when you actually observe these spectras, what we have seen is that these galaxies are moving away from us rather than moving towards us. And this became a complete mystery at that time. And then in 1920, Edwin Hubble used Cepheid variables or Cepheid stars to measure the distances to many nearby spiral galaxies. And he found the connection between this galaxy's distance and the size of its redshift. And remember that in the morning we learned that these Cepheid stars were used by Hubble to decide the distances to Andromeda galaxy, right? In the similar way, he used different number of Cepheid variables to measure the distances to many spiral galaxies, not only for the Andromeda. Now we have used the same method to measure the distances to different spiral galaxies. And interestingly, he found this nice relationship between the galaxy's distance that he have measured with the size of its redshift. Because you can measure the redshift from the spectra and then you measure the distance to that particular galaxy using a Cepheid variable, right? So once he measured all these galaxies and distances and the redshift, he have seen that there is a relationship between the distance and the redshift. So what he has seen is nearby galaxies have relatively small spectral redshift. Those that are closest to us sometimes are blue shifted. This includes the Andromeda galaxy. In general, what he has observed is these nearby galaxies have relatively small spectral redshift, right? So their redshift was smaller. And even when the galaxy is very close to us, sometimes even they are blue shifted, which means they come towards us, right? Now this one example is that Andromeda spiral galaxy. When you look at the spectra of the Andromeda, it is blue shifted, which means the Andromeda galaxy is coming towards us. But except that one, all these distant galaxies that he has observed, they are actually red shifted, which means in general, we can tell that almost all the galaxies are moving away from us. There are exceptions such as Andromeda spiral galaxy because it is so close to us. So the gravity dominates there, right? This attraction force. And what he has found was that when you look at the redshift and the distance, this redshift is directly proportional to the distance. Right, and the other thing is when you know the redshift value of a galaxy, you can convert that particular redshift value directly to a velocity, that is recession velocity. Either the galaxy is moving away from us or towards us, you can calculate that using the redshift. And I will show you an example. You have probably seen this in your very early lectures as well, the relationship between the redshift and the recessional velocity. Now, when Hubble found this relationship, which is the relationship between the redshift or the recessional velocity and the distance to that particular galaxy, right? Now, this relationship is now called as the Hubble law, and this is very famous. And this is what he has observed at that time. The x-axis shows the distance to a particular set of galaxies, and the y-axis is the recessional velocity, how fast a particular galaxy is moving away from us. You can see that when the distance increases, that the recessional velocity increases. So that means the redshift also increases, right? Now you can see that nice linear relationship. So higher the distance, the larger the velocity that a particular galaxy is moving away from us, right? Now this Hubble law has very profound implications. One of those is actually, and also the most straightforward one, is that the space between galaxies is expanding in a uniform manner. So if the galaxies that are far away from us are moving faster, what you can conclude from that is the space between galaxies is expanding, right? In a uniform manner. Now you have to understand this clearly. It is actually not the galaxy itself is expanding. It is the space between galaxies that are expanding, right? So the shape and the size of the galaxy will not change. It is the space itself that is expanding. And we used to tell that the universe itself is expanding, right? Now this is the primary discovery that we astronomers did to state that the universe is expanding, right? Now, if you have a further away galaxy, then you have more space there between us and that galaxy. So that means the galaxies that are so far away are actually expanding maybe at a higher recessional velocity, right? And you can see it from this graph as well. When the distance increases, the recessional velocity of the galaxy is also increasing. Right. Now the other thing is, even though you see that a particular galaxy appear to be moving away from us, we are not at the center of the universe, right? So we cannot state that we are at the center of the universe, right? What we can say is galaxies appear to be moving away from us, but if you consider about, let's say there is an alien in a different galaxy, he or she would see the same effect, right? So he would see that all the galaxies are moving away from him or her as well, right? What we are seeing from here will be very similar, right? Galaxies are moving away from us. Because of that, you cannot say that Earth is at the center of the, we are at the center of the universe. You cannot tell it like that, right? So this diagram basically shows you how it looks like about when you talk about the expansion of the universe. What you need to understand here is that there are this each dot may represent a galaxy, and you can see that today it looks like this, but when it expanded, the distance between galaxies have increased, right? So these distances keep increasing when the universe is expanding, right? So they move away each other, and you cannot tell that a particular location where you can have as the center here in this diagram, right? So everyone is moving away from everyone. And in future, it will get more expanded, and all these galaxies will be far, more and more far away from each other. Here is another example, and you can actually do this yourself. If you take a balloon, if you have the balloon in this shape, let's say you have some dots like that you see in this balloon. Once you expand the balloon, you will see that all these dots will be, separate from each other little by little when you get this balloon expanded, right? So you can see that this in this diagram, so they are more closer. You can see that they are more closer, but here they are far away from each other, and this is even far away from each other. So like that, the galaxies will be there, their shape will not change due to this effect. What will happen is the space between galaxies will expand, right? Now the next question is, what exactly is expanding? So I think I gave you the answer now. Ordinary things like atoms, people, stars and galaxies, they are actually not expanding. These things are held together by their own internal force. Even between distant galaxies, the expansion is not noticeable, only at fairly large separations. Small separation separations, the relative motion of galaxies are generally dominated by gravity. So that's what has happened for Andromeda galaxy. Because if you consider Andromeda and Milky Way, they are actually moving towards each other because they are so close and the gravity generally dominates it, right? So that's what I have mentioned at small separations, because when you have small separations, the gravitational force is higher, right? Because of that, gravity will take the lead at that point. And then, right, so we learn about the basic idea behind the Hubble law, and then what we actually mean by expansion of the universe, right? And what exactly expanding. Now let's look at a little bit more into this Hubble constant. As I showed you earlier, the Hubble law tells us that the universe is expanding smoothly. And with careful measurements, it is also possible to determine how fast it is expanding. And this is easy. As you see in this diagram right here, you can see from the gradient of this diagram, you can measure how fast a particular galaxy is expanding away from us, right? Now, to get it, you have to use this graph. Now, if you take the gradient of this graph, the gradient is always a constant. So this gradient is always a constant, right? That's what we have used here. The Hubble constant is normally defined as H naught equal V over D. So that is V means this part right here, and then the D is the distance, right? If you know these two, basically it is the gradient of this graph, the Hubble constant. So the advantage is if you know the Hubble constant, you can actually calculate the recessional velocity or the distance to that particular galaxy, right? Right, now in this slide, you can kind of see Hubble law is expressed in this term. I think everybody should remember this law, right? And one of the issues that I have seen over and over in exams is that using correct units here for the correct calculation, right? Remember that units are very important in astronomy, because the units that we use here is not general units that we use in day-to-day life. Right, and because of that, please be careful with the units, and also at the same time, if you use correct units, the answers are you can solve the answers very easily. Now here V is the recessional velocity and D is the distance to that particular galaxy, right? Now once you get the ratio of those two, it will give you the Hubble constant. Right. And you know, we discuss about the parsecs, and 1 megaparsec is 1,000,000 parsecs, and h naught is the Hubble constant, and normally it is measured as kilometers per second per megaparsec, right? There may be other units that normally people use as well, right? Now, if we assume that the Hubble law is the same everywhere, then the Hubble constant will become a universal fixed quantity, right? But actually, the reality is when you go for very far away distances, Hubble constant will also change. But we can roughly assume it as a constant for nearby galaxies. Here are actually two examples that uses the Hubble law. And you can see that here the first question is asking Hubble laws allow how to calculate the distance to any galaxy. And here is an example. We have measured Hubble's constant to be 22 kilometers per second per million light years. So it's a different unit. And then if you find the galaxy that is moving away at 18,000 kilometers per second, then your question is, what does Hubble law tells us about the distance to the galaxy? And all you need to do is plug everything to this equation, V equal HD. And the velocity is given as 18,000 kilometers per second. And since in the Hubble law also there is 22 kilometers per second right here, and because of that, this unit will cancel out, right? So that you don't need to worry about converting units, right? So these are like important points when you do real-time problems, so that you will not spend time to convert the units, right? So I have another example here, how to use the Hubble law, and you can use both. Right, so is there anyone who have a question up to here? And also, if you have a question, please post those into chat so that I can answer, right? Right, so if you do not have questions, so let me just give me a few minutes. I am going to leave here for something, and I will be back in within 1 or 2 minutes, right? So just bear with me. Right, so now let's see how we can measure this Hubble constant. Now, if you want to determine the Hubble constant, what we need to measure is accurate precession velocities and distances to remote galaxies. And this is exactly what Hubble did. Now, if you want to measure the Hubble constant, what you need to do is find the precession velocities, which can be measured to very high precision, particularly for distant galaxies, right? And that is because basically these galaxies are less affected by the local galaxy motions, which means the motions due to the gravity, right? And the distance measurements, actually they are much more uncertain in many, and many techniques have been used. Remember that we have used CEPID's variables to measure distances. And also, if you remember that we have talked about carbon detonation or type, carbon detonation supernova. These are like type 2 supernovas. And you can use both these methods to measure the distances. And by measuring the distances and the recessional velocities, you can plot that graph and can make the take the gradient of the graph, which can be related to the Hubble constant. Right? In this way, astronomers have now measured the Hubble constant. And actually, there are a lot of stories behind this Hubble constant, because some people thought in the past that it should be around 50 according to their experiment, and some thought that it should be around 100 according to their experiment. But from the latest results that we have from the Planck data, which was a satellite that sent to the space around 5 or 6 years back, is actually the actual value is around 67. But this, when I was making this slide, it was around 74.3 plus or minus 2.1 kilometers per second per megaparsecs. Right. Once again, please make a note on that units that you have here. So, which means if you have the recessional velocity in terms of kilometers per second, the distance will come directly from in terms of parsecs. Right. So it is very important that you keep track on these units when you are using the Hubble scope, right? Which will make things a lot easier. Otherwise, I have seen that students trying to convert, when I gave a problem to find the distance for them, they try to convert everything to meters and then megaparsecs into meters and try to do this, the problem. You don't need to do that, right? Because if the velocity comes in terms of kilometers per second, that kilometers per second will cancel out with the units of the Hubble constant. Automatically, you will get this in terms of megaparsecs, right? So depending on the problem, you have to think. Right, so that's how you find the Hubble constant. And now, once you know the Hubble constant, there is an advantage. Because knowing the Hubble constant, then you can use it to find the distances. To find the distances in this way, we will be using the redshift values. Right. What we will normally do is, you first go outside and look at the spectrum of an object. In this case, it should most probably it should be a galaxy, and then you can find the recessional velocity. Once you know the redshift of a galaxy, that redshift can be converted into a recessional velocity. Right. So just keep my word for now for that, and I will show you how you convert velocity and the redshift value into velocity in the next slide. And then you have to choose the appropriate value for the Hubble constant. Now, if you are given a question in the exam paper, we used to give the Hubble constant normally. If you need that, except for situations where you have to find the Hubble constant, right? And then once you know the recessional velocity that comes from the redshift, and if you know the current Hubble constants for the universe, you can find the distance. You just need to plug those two values to these equations, right? Now, even in an exam, these kind of simple calculations, I would expect that you would be able to do. And actually, this technique, that relationship that comes from Hubble's law, they have used it to map out vast regions of the universe, because if you have a spectrometer, you can take the spectrum of these very distant galaxies, which will directly convert them into a recessional velocity, and you will have the distance already, right? From that, using the Hubble law. And here is the part that I did not discuss, how to calculate the recessional velocity from the redshift. Right, so what you normally measure is this redshift value, shift of the wavelength from the spectra. Once you measure it, all you need to do is you have to multiply it from C to get the recessional velocity, right? So it is not that much hard, and I have given you an example here in the down as well, how you look at the value of the redshift and also how to find this recessional velocity, right? So all you need to do is find a value for the redshift, and then once you know it, you just need to multiply your value by the speed of light, to find the residual velocity. Right. So that's about the Hubble's constant. And then if you look at the largest structure in the universe. Now, astronomers used this previous method, which is about using the redshift to estimate the distances using the Hubble law. You know that you can do that now. And using this method, astronomers carried out very large redshift surveys, which means they set up a huge telescope with a spectrometer and look at different areas of the sky and then find the redshift values for those spectra. And once you know the redshift and the Hubble constant, you can directly calculate the distance to any particular galaxy line. And that's what they have done exactly. And once they did this for a large number of galaxies using one of these huge surveys, this is what they had. And this is our galaxy right here. And then here are the structures that they have. One is right here and one is right here. There are a few things that seems to be interesting. And you can see there is something called Great Wall here. It's a collection of, you know, galaxies and clusters that looks like a wall in our own galaxy cluster. Not our own galaxy cluster, in our universe actually. So this is, and there is a southern wall right here as well. And the other thing is, you can see that there are empty space, right, between galaxies. So you cannot see galaxy like in each and every void here. There are empty voids. And that's what I have mentioned here. Surprisingly enough, there are also some enormous voids which contain very few galaxies. So that means you have some voids in between galaxies. And there is the largest void is around 100 megaparsecs that they have detected. And here is the universe looks like. And what you can understand from here is the galaxies are actually not, you know, randomly distributed, right? So they have clustered at certain points, and then there are voids in between those. Now, if you like to estimate the age of the universe, you can actually make a rough estimate using the Hubble's law. Because once you know the Hubble constant, you can actually use that to find the age of the universe, right? And there will be a tutorial question for this one. This is a very easy one, so I would like all of you to do that question when I post the tutorial. I mean, the idea is, knowing the Hubble constant, you can directly calculate the age of the universe very roughly, right? Using like simple mathematics. Right, if you calculate the age of the universe, it will come out as the universe is around 14 billion years old now, right? In fact, the exact answer is around 13.7 billion years, but let's say universe is now 14 billion years old. Now, if the universe is, you know, around 14 billion years old, so what we think is that then the universe probably has created 14 billion years ago from now, right? And this theory that we talk about, the beginning of the universe around 14 billion years ago, is called as the Big Bang, right? And in fact, what we used to tell is that it appears that the universe itself began at that time. So that means 14 billion years ago is the point where the universe itself began, right? Now, how it began is a different question. Now, we thought that universe is thought to have begun with a huge explosion known as the Big Bang. So what we know up to now is, close to 14 billion years ago, there was an event, which is an explosion. And this is called actually Big Bang. And this explosion is the one that is responsible for the beginning of the universe, which we now identified as this Big Bang, right? Now, Hubble law tells us that the universe is expanding everywhere we look. If the universe is expanding everywhere, we can tell that this implies that there is no special location in the universe where the Big Bang originated, right? So you cannot make a statement by showing a certain point telling that this is the place where the Big Bang started, right? We used to tell that it took place everywhere, because at that point, you know, you just have a very small tiny volume at that time. This expansion has begun after the Big Bang. And there will be some slides, actually, I'm going to skip for the time being. Right, now, remember that I told that there was a huge explosion around 14 billion years ago, which will lead to the start of the universe, or the beginning of the universe, and we call that as the Big Bang, right? Now, when you make such a statement, in science, then you need to make sure that you thoroughly check it again and again to see whether what you are telling is correct, right? So if we state that the universe has began 13 or 14 billion years ago from now, we have to study it and prove it or show that we have sufficient evidence to tell it like that way, right? Now, so I'm going to talk one such evidence here. Now, if the universe really did begin at a finite time in the past, it should start to look different as we look out to larger and larger distance. So what that means is, if the universe has begun at a finite time in the past, let's say 14 billion years ago, when you look back in the time, you should see different universes at different times, right? And we now have the possibility to look at the galaxies that are around 13 billion light years away from us. And we have also identified these distant quasars and radio galaxies. And if you look at more and more back into the time, which means we are basically looking at the high redshift universe, right? So more older stuff. And what we actually see is galaxies look more irregular and are forming stars at much higher rate than they are now. And galaxy interactions appear to be more common. And quasars are far more common than they are nearby. And the idea is, you know, when the universe was at the beginning, when the universe was starting from the Big Bang, the galaxies had completely different shapes, right? Now, it is this galaxy evolutionary process that made these spirals and elliptical galaxies. But at the beginning of the universe, there was no such shapes for the galaxies. Now, these when you look at all these different redshift universes, which means you are going back time little by little and see how the galaxies looks like, you will clearly see that in the nearby universe, you have a lot of ellipticals and spiral galaxies. But when you go back in time, you will see more and more irregular type of galaxies, right? So that's because at that time, galaxies are just forming. And so you can see that all these observations that we are talking are kind of consistent with the Big Bang, which is the fact that the universe has begun from one of these explosions at a particular place. And from there on, universe started to expand. Right, the other thing is, one of the strongest evidence that we have up to date is this cosmic microwave background, which we predicted from the Big Bang theory, and also we have observed experimentally, right? And so the idea is, at very early times, the universe was very dense and hot, right? And what we expect is it could have been filled with a very high energy radiation giving off a black body spectrum, right? So that's because of this very high temperature, we expect that you will get a black body spectrum. And the temperature at this particular point is normally used to assumed as greater than 1 billion Kelvin. And then as I told, as I have mentioned in this previous sentence, that at the beginning of the universe, there should be the universe should be filled with this very high energy radiation, right? And this high energy radiation is giving off from the black body spectrum, and you can consider this very very high. The universe was very hot and dense at that time, and the temperature was greater than 1 billion Kelvin. And under this condition, you will have this universe filled with very high energy radiation. And if it is filled with this high energy radiation, the idea is we should be able to detect that high energy radiation, right? However, there is a problem, because now the universe has, if you are going to detect that radiation now, you can understand that now universe has expanded so much, and because of expansion, all these wavelengths are redshifted, and you should see something like this today. And here is the time where this radiation emitted, not actually radiation emitted, after 1 second of the emission, right? Because of this redshifted values, they have become gamma rays after 1 second. And after 10 to the power 5 years, they are in the optical region, and then into the infrared region. And then today, this should be in the radio wavelengths, right? And here is the frequency, and here is the intensity of the wave. And this is, you know, this is how the Wien's displacement law works as well. Initially, you have gamma rays. After some time, when you when these radiation is redshifted, right? Initially, you have there as gamma rays, and once the time goes on, they are further and further more redshifted. And after 10 to the power 5 years, it's actually has become optical region, in the optical region, right? So we are basically talking about this radiation emitted after the Big Bang. And what we are telling is, since the universe is expanding, all the wavelengths are redshifted, and because of that, this wavelength is also peak wavelength is redshifted, and have gone to these low frequency, high wavelength values. And today, we should be able to see those, we used to tell that this is the afterglow of the Big Bang, or this radiation, we should be able to see from a radio telescope, right? And in fact, that is what scientists, these two, the two American scientists called Robert Wilson and Arno Penzias, did in 1964. Right. So what they have found was, there is an annoying background of radio waves in all parts of the sky when they were trying to set up an antenna. Right. And initially they thought that this was a problem with the telescope. However, they realized that this disturbing wave is coming from the sky itself. Right. And this is the first time that people have, astronomers have discovered or observed this cosmic microwave background radiation, which is actually predicted from the Big Bang theory, but nobody have found. And you can see that they first predict it, and then they measure the rate. They have realized that all the galaxies are redshifting, and because of that, they expect that, okay, and around 1964, when that time comes, this radiation should be shifted to this radio wavelength, right? And then they set up this antenna and everything. Actually, they were doing a different experiment. They were not planning to detect this cosmic microwave background. However, they were able to discover this disturbing radio waves in each and every direction, right? And this is called cosmic microwave background, and they found found that cosmic microwave background radiation. And this is actually a very strong support for the Big Bang theory, because it is predicted right here. Universe was started with a very high temperature and in a dense environment with temperature greater than 1 million Kelvin. And under this condition, we expect that there should be a very high energy radiation giving off in the black body spectrum. And this radiation we expect after, you know, so much, 14 billion years, we expect that the one thing is this radiation is greatly redshifted, and now they should be able, this radiation should be in the microwave range, which is around 1 millimeter. And at the same time, the universe has cooled down and the temperature is about 3 Kelvin. Now when you detect it, right? And also the other thing is it should be seen in all directions in the sky. So it doesn't matter which direction that you are looking at, you should always see cosmic microwave background. So that is the idea, right? So they had this theoretical prediction initially, depending on the redshift values that they have, you should detect this. And the idea is they were able to detect it using these antennas, which are basically used to detect radio waves in 1964. And in fact, they got the Nobel Prize for this one as well. So they are the people who discovered cosmic microwave background, which is one of the strongest evidence to tell that the universe is, universe started from the Big Bang, right? And here is actually the measured cosmic microwave background radiation in the universe right now. And the different colors are actually very small temperature differences that we have in different regions that once you measured it. And as far as I remember, this results came from the Planck satellite around 2015. And you can see that if you look at these tiny variations, these variations are colored to identify that there are very small variations. However, the temperature seems to be very close to 3 Kelvin everywhere, and there are very small changes that is what you can see from this map with different colors. However, the overall temperature is very close to 3 Kelvin, right? And also there is a method that you can estimate the Hubble constant in this way. And this is the latest results that we have for the Hubble constant as well. And we know that the age of the universe is also estimated in this way. And the most recent correct value for the age of the universe is 13.799. And actually, so I think I probably would finish quickly. And here is a nice diagram that shows you what has happened starting from the Big Bang. Here is the place where the Big Bang has started. And you can see here is the place at the same time the time has started and temperature is infinite at that particular time. And after that, the universe gradually cooled off like this. And you have formation of, you know, deuterium and helium. There is a story behind this, right? Since there are general degree students as well, I am not going to explain it in too much details, but we will do it in our special degree course. The idea that you have to get here is the universe has started from this explosion in a very hot and dense environment called Big Bang. After that, there was a period called inflation, which means there is a sudden expansion within a very quick time. And then the deuterium and helium formed. And then you have the cosmic microwave background right here. And there is a radiation matter energy equivalency. And then you get galaxies formed after that. Like that, you go step by step. And you can see in this region, the galaxies do not have a specific shape. But when it comes into the today's universe right here. The galaxies have these nice shapes that we talk, right? And this is, in summary, what has happened starting from the Big Bang up to now. And initially, these two, this is actually what has happened since the Big Bang. Initially, we had a radiation-dominated universe. So that's why this blue line has gone higher compared to the red line. However, after some time, what has happened was the situation has changed. Then now we have a matter-dominated universe rather than the radiation-dominated universe, right? We have more matter now in the universe. And I will skip these parts. I mean, you can read through what happens before the Big Bang, those kind of things. And the next thing what we basically learned today is about the motion of galaxies, how the galaxies move in the space, and we deduce from that the Hubble law, and we told that the universe is expanding. And also then we move into the talk about the Big Bang theory, what has happened 14 billion light years ago. And in around 14 billion years ago, we discussed that there is a sudden explosion in a very hot, dense environment. And after this explosion, everything got expanded and come to a point where we are right now. And we supported with different evidences for that. And one of the main evidences is the cosmic microwave background that we have, right? And now let's see what will happen to the universe in future. Will the universe expand forever? Now we know that the universe has started from the Big Bang, and then it continued to expand from that point. And we know that now the universe is expanding. Now the next question is, will the universe expand forever? Will this expansion will continue forever? Right, so let's look at that part. Now we now know that the universe is currently expanding at a rate of 74 kilometers per second for megaparsec. Now just to note that this could change right at any time, and because these are different values taken from different satellites and those kind of stuff. And the question that we have is, will this continue forever? Right. So. The one idea is that the presence of matter should slow the expansion of the universe, since the gravity is an attractive force. Right? Everybody knows that these are huge masses that are moving, expanding. However, they are actually attracted from the gravitational forces as well. And because of that, presence of this huge matter now, this will slow down the expansion of the universe, right? So that is basically due to the fact that the gravitational forces, right? However, if the rate of acceleration is large enough, the universe might eventually stop expanding and begin to collapse, right? Now, if this deacceleration rate is very large, then the universe might eventually stop at some point and will try to expand, try to collapse, right? So the idea is, if the expansion is, the deacceleration rate is large enough, it can happen as well. Universe will expand and will stop at certain point and will come down again, right? And the other thing is, if the rate of deacceleration is small enough, the universe will expand forever. If you do not have much deacceleration, the universe could expand forever, right? And this is called an unbounded universe. So all these things can happen. Actually, we normally use this parameter, which we called as density parameter or the critical density, and depending on this value, we can actually decide what kind of universe that we are living, right? And normally this is defined as the ratio of observed densities and the critical density, right? And this critical density has a different definition, that is the density required for a flat universe. Now, if the universe to become a flat universe, what kind of density that we need? and that density is called a critical density, and this is the value of that critical density. Let me go in. Right, now this one right here is important. Now, astronomers, by keep that critical density value in mind, astronomers actually have tried to measure the expansion rates of the universe. And basically, this has done using carbon detonation supernova or type 2 supernova. And once they try to measure the expansion rates, they found a very surprising result. Instead of slowing down the expansion rate, which is what we expected due to the gravitational forces, the expansion is actually accelerating now. And this has found by looking at these carbon detonation supernovas. However, the expansion is accelerating, and this became a complete surprise at that time, because everyone was thinking that when the universe is now expanded, because of the gravitational forces, this expansion will slow down, right? But instead of showing that, once they measured these expansion rates using carbon detonation supernova, what they have observed is that the universe is accelerating, right? And this means that the universe is not bounded. And the problem is, when this is accelerating, there is no way that we can explain it now, because the gravity alone cannot explain it. Gravity is an attractive force now. Now, this whatever the force or thing that creates this acceleration, it should be a repulsive one, right? Because it's accelerating or moving away from us. And because of that, then astronomers thought that there must be an additional repulsive force at this point, right? And this mysterious force is what we refer as dark energy, right? And we actually do not know yet what causes this repulsion, right, to make this acceleration of the universe. But we name whatever the mysterious force as the dark energy, right? And this is where you found dark energy. So dark energy concept came into around some 20 some years ago. And remember, we learned about dark matter previously when we talk about galaxies. Those dark matter is a kind of matter that still we don't know. However, it is responsible for attracting everything, right? Now here, this dark energy is actually something like a repulsive force, which is responsible for this acceleration. Right? And actually, when Einstein was deriving his Einstein field equation, which is what you can see here, I guess probably generally these students may know about this. He actually has entered this part into his equation purposely, because he was in the view that the universe is not accelerating. It should be a static universe, right? And to keep it, to make it static, he actually add this extra term right here for his Einstein equation to make a static universe. However, now in 1998, these astronomers found that the universe is expanding, which means it is not a static universe, right? And since he put this purposely from his hand to the equation to make it work at that time, he later identified that this was one of the biggest blunders that he did in his life, right, by adding this term to make it a static universe. Because what he had in his mind was actually, we are living in a static universe. So that's why he included this. But in reality, once you do all these observations, we have found that we are not actually living in a static universe. Our universe is expanding, right? Right. Now, remember that I talked with you about this cosmological density parameter or omega parameter previously. Now, depending on this value of this omega, we can tell the fate of the universe. If this density parameter is greater than 1, universe, we used to tell that the universe have a positive curvature and is finite. And if omega equal 1, then we used to tell that we will be living in a flat and infinite universe. And if this less than 1, the universe is negatively curved and infinite universe, right? And you can actually measure this omega density parameter for a certain region of the universe and do the conclusions. And very surprisingly, this is what we have up to now from the measurements. From the normal matter, critical density contributes 0.05, and from the dark matter, 0.25, and dark energy is 0.7. So you have to combine all these three values, or add all these three values to get the final critical density, density parameter, right? And this, once you add these three, this will become 1, right? So that means this condition right here, if omega becomes 1, we should live in a flat universe. And this is what we know up to now. We are living in a flat universe. And here is an image again from the Big Bang, starting right here. What has happened to these objects? How it is, first you have the radiation dominated universe, and then you have different kind of matter, and then the galaxies form around this region. And now they are moving apart from each other. Right, so to finish up the lecture, since I took maybe more time from you, here is what we know up to now. I mean, 95% of our universe we don't know, because 95% is made up from dark energy and dark matter, right? These two parts, right? So we don't know what they are made of. This part is hidden for us. So all we know is this 5% right here, the heavy elements that we find in Earth and everywhere, is what we know up to now. And this part we don't know. And because of that, we used to tell that 95% of the universe is unknown, because we don't know what they are made of. Right, so let me stop from there. So I went through very quickly with the last part. Now for the general degree students, you don't need to worry too much about that, but I expect from you to remember some of these important parameters. For example, I would expect from you to how to handle this Hubble constant and Hubble law, and maybe find the distance to a particular galaxy using the Hubble law and converting redshift to a recessional velocity. Those kind of simple things I have given to you as examples as well. So I would expect that you can do those things yourself. Other than that, normally these geometries of the universe, you can just get a basic idea, like what kind of universe that we are living, and whether the universe is accelerating or deaccelerating, and then what is this density parameter, and what you can tell from that, right? So very basic idea is enough. So that's why I just skip most of the stuff, some of things that you don't need, but I will be taking on those points for those special degrees that you have joined today. But I will take on those points in a later day again to discuss a little bit more, because there are a lot that we have to discuss inside those. Right, so anybody have any questions? Right, so if not, let me finish now. I think this completes all the general degree lectures for general degree students. So I will not have any lectures from here on. However, I will be posting few tutorials and few exercises for you to practice for your exams. And probably I will probably have a session, one or two sessions like this, before your exams. At any point, once the exam is scheduled, I will probably talk to all of you, those who are doing the general degree, to explain the format and what kind of you know, kind of things that you have to practice and all those things. Right, so if you do not have any questions, let me stop for now and we will... meet again at any point to, you know, revise these lectures and do some few exercises and those kind of things later, right? So up to now, your lectures are completely done now, and I will upload these notes to the LMS as well. Right, then thank you for joining, and since the time has passed, I know that there are some students who have some lectures at 6 as well, so I'm going to stop.